Hi, it's Jeff.
And Denise from Mousesteps.com.
And this is episode number 217.
217.
Of Mousesteps Weekly.
Sponsored by MEI Travel and Mouse Fan Travel. They are our official travel agency. Sign up for their newsletter with the latest Disney deals delivered to your inbox. They deal with Walt Disney World, Disneyland, Disney Cruise Line, Alani, and so much more.
Not to mention Universal.
Universal.
The whole world.
The whole world of travel.
Of goodness.
And we highly recommend them. They have agents all over the country.
Also, the AllEars.net weekly newsletter.
They have a very interesting feature article this week by Disney historian Jim Corcus on Mr. Lincoln and the Gettysburg Address. That's actually one of the more interesting articles I've read on
there. I just read it myself, yes.
And they also have updates on Walt Disney World news, including Pandora's May 27th opening date, news about starring roles closing, which surprised me like a week ago when that happened.
Right.
The Geyser Point Pool Bar and Grill opening February 13th at Disney's Wilderness Lodge, and updates on the 2017 Epcot Flower and Garden Festival.
Check out the show notes for full information.
And so much more.
So we're starting off this week at Disney's Animal Kingdom. Big doings just came out of nowhere.
Well, Disney had announced that Rivers of Light, after a lengthy delay,
about 9 or 10 months,
yes, would actually debut on February 17th for guests.
And we all scrambled. Everybody got their fast passes. I think we even made reservations for dining. And then out of nowhere, on the morning of the 10th, fast passes became available. It soft opened.
Right.
So we had our fast pass and we went, and we have now seen Rivers of Light. So we'll be talking all about that on this week's show. But first, let's take a look at the merchandise. Disney, for once, did not, I guess they did have plenty of time to get this stuff ready. They did not miss out on having full merchandise available for the soft opening debut.
Well, there was a lot more. I wasn't expecting much. Maybe a CD, which we didn't see, but I guess they have it.
Right. That's been out, apparently.
And a shirt or something. So they have like everything. I mean, they have magnets. You can see them, pens and t-shirts.
And these things
ornament.
Here are glow with the show little guys.
I guess it's like a totem.
Like a wand, a little wand they have that changes color. Yeah, yeah. It's like
I think,
animal totem.
I think on the article I said I didn't know what it was, but somebody called it a totem. So
and these things glow
that.
Too and move. All of it is light. There's light upable.
Right, except there's also blankets and like a blanket and a towel and a pin. So there's like a million different things.
I thought the merchandise was pretty cool. Like you said, I'm glad that they had everything ready. And you know, that blanket would have been handy on the 10th. They got a little chilly, which is very unusual for an Animal Kingdom show.
A little chilly, but it was nice because everybody is so close together in the theater. So not having the heat and the humidity right now is a big plus. And there also, you have a sweatshirt. I don't know if that one might have been for kids. And the mug is actually quite nice.
So I think my favorite item of all is coming up. It's this fan here where you can see animals sort of come to life with light animation as you're watching the show. Imagine if the whole theater had these things with the show.
I wouldn't want that, like, because then that's all you'll see and you won't even see the show at all.
Yes. Okay.
We didn't buy anything.
I did not buy it, but I do think it's pretty cool. Tell us about the wristbands.
Well, we had been given the Rivers of Light wristbands. We already had the Fast Pass and we ended up letting go of that and taking the wristband instead.
Right, because I really like the dining package viewing area. They have a area, and I'm going to show it actually right here. This is where we sat. But I like because if you get in the last row, which we did, you can stand up and record. You don't get in anybody's way. And it's just, even have a wall to lean against.
That
so it's
was
a perfect
really
location.
Nice.
Worked out good for us.
And we knew about it because we had done the dining package during the Jungle Book Alive with Magic show. And so we sat back there.
Correct. So one thing I should mention, and you could see it's sort of just the end of sunset. If there are two shows on the night you go, I would recommend the first show because part of the fun is watching the day turn to night and all the colors come out of nowhere. So I think that adds to the fun.
I thought that was nice too. And you can see the elephants there. Also, they had projections kind of along the trees. There's a lot of lights. It's really a nice experience.
And one thing also is it starts off slow. You know, you sit there, you're in the audience and the lotus come out and they start moving around and it kind of gets you into the mood of the show and then it starts.
Right. And it's a short show, at least to me it is. It's a 15-minute show. And if you compare that to Jungle Book Alive with Magic, that was about a 25-minute show. And they have cut this back from when they did cast member previews.
Correct.
Probably for the best.
Mm-hmm.
But, you know, I am expecting that they will be tweaking this one and maybe it will get a little longer, but who knows. Disney says that it's a visual mix of water, fire, nature, and light with an original musical score. this is not a Disney character type show at all.
Right. You do have storytellers. You do have live performers on the boats there, the Discovery boats you just saw, though.
But I don't know what they do. It's not like with the Jungle Book show where they're so close to you. I couldn't really see them, so I'm not even sure what they were doing.
Well, a lot of their storytelling is supposedly with shadow, and they never speak. Later on, if we have time, we can read the official Disney description, and it tells what the storytellers are there for.
Well, I thought the shadows were interesting, but then you have also these animal floats coming out, and they change colors. There are giant water screens, which you had seen, and they have animal imagery, including Disney nature films. Mm-hmm. I mean, as far as never seen footage.
Well, here is some of that animal imagery on the giant water screens now in the background there, and you'll see it more coming up. I thought it worked much better here than in the Jungle Book show. I much preferred Rivers of Light over the Jungle Book show.
I thought they were, you know, there were elements that I really liked, including the live performance of the Jungle Book show. That is, for me, was better. But the show itself with the music and
music
the
is
lights,
great. I love the soundtrack.
Oh, absolutely. There's a song called We Are One, which sounds like it should be in Illuminations. Mm-hmm. This is a 5,000 seat amphitheater also. So I don't expect they'll ever have more than two shows, really, because it's really an hour and a half process, at least, for them to load and unload and to have a 15-minute show.
There's looks like some Disney nature type stuff. They're real great, and I really like the projections, although I do think the second act does get a little long for me. That's my only critique is, you know, at one point you see lots of projections and there's not much else going on. So I think I wish that there was always activity mm-hmm. happening.
I totally agree with that. And also, just the animals that we showed, they're like animal spirits. I mean, you won't know that. Like, I don't think there's really a story, but they are storytellers are summoning animal spirits.
Well, not unlike Illuminations and Wishes. I think most people don't get the full story necessarily.
I don't get the full story for most shows.
Well, I will link the official Disney description in the show notes if you're interested. Really, all you have to know is there's cool projections, there's great music, there's lots of really nice, colorful lighting, water,
fire.
I mean, that's what it's really all about. That's what it's about. You're watching fire here. There's animal
imagery.
You know, you don't need to know, I guess, all that backstory. It's just a fun, relaxing end of the night show at Animal Kingdom.
And you can get dining packages. And I would recommend it if you can't get a fast pass, I would get a dining package, especially since a lot of nights may only have one show. 5,000 guests at most in the theater. Mm-hmm. Tiffin's is one of the restaurants, and then Tusker House, they both have dining packages. Personally, we will recommend Tiffin's. We do have a Jungle Book Alive with Magic review of Tiffin's with that dining package, which should work pretty much the same.
Correct. And depending on what you order, you can even come out ahead of the game.
Right. And that would not happen at Tusker House. However, if you're on the Disney dining plan, which isn't something I totally recommend, but, you know, a lot of guests get it because it's convenient. Mm-hmm. I would personally go with the one credit over at Tusker House for lunch or dinner, as opposed to two credits for Tiffin's, unless you're really wanting to dine at Tiffin's, and then certainly go for that.
Okay, so bottom line, what did you think of Rivers of Light?
Well, I went into it thinking that I wasn't going to enjoy the show that much, but it exceeded my expectations. I thought it was very nice. I mean, it is a lot of time investment. It can be for a 15-minute show, but I enjoyed it. So I when I wrote on Twitter, I said I liked it.
Right. And one thing about this show is the videos that we saw previous just didn't do it justice. There's something about being there in person. It's a different type of show. It's very abstract. It kind of reminds me of the old parade at Epcot.
Tapestry of Dreams,
mm-hmm. Tapestry of Nations, right? So I don't know. I liked it. I can't wait to go back. I look forward to seeing it without having to look through the viewfinder. So I think it'll be a nice ending to a night at Disney's Animal Kingdom, especially with the projections on the trees and, of course, Pandora and all this opening. I have a feeling we'll be spending much more time at Animal Kingdom this year.
And speaking of spending more time, I didn't think it was possible to spend more time at Epcot than I normally do. But because of the Festival of the Arts, we spent even more time. And the Epcot Flower and Garden Festival, this is a time when right now you can see the flower quilt is coming in. So we're going to see topiaries popping up soon. This is one of my
Denise Epcot was so
I
excited. So excited to see the quilt. I knew the quilt was there, but I didn't tell her. I think I spilled the beans on the way there, though.
If I could be at Epcot every day right now, I would be, because you know, it's like a surprise every single day. And that reminds me of Pac-Man there.
Yes.
I end up eating the flowers and about to eat the monorail.
You realize it's just the circle that the sun is in.
But no, but...
I know, I see the Pac-Man. Like the Pac-Man. And there's one on the other side, too.
So, yes, and the Epcot Flower and Garden Festival starts on March 1st. We can see here at this, there's going to be a flower quilt over here as well. It wasn't in yet. And
those flags are always a sign that it's coming imminently.
Very soon, right. And this is actually going to be our 11th year posting about the Epcot Flower and Garden Festival. I usually do like a photo blowout, and we try some of the outdoor kitchens and such. It runs 90 days this year, just like last year.
Right. Now, this is one of the new playgrounds, right? Is this a new playground that we're looking at?
Well, it's the same playground as before, but it could be a new playground in the old areas. But I actually am not sure exactly what they're putting. Oh, you know what? I think I did read they're having the Magic Musical Melodies Garden back.
Okay. So it'll be the one from last time. Mm-hmm. Very good.
So this year, though, what will be new is the Bell Topiary is actually getting a face, just like Elsa and Anna and
Emma Watson,
Snow White.
Right?
No, it's not. I don't think Emma Watson will be there. And she's also going to have a yellow ball gown. So that should be very interesting.
So it'll be the classic Belle face, the animated Belle
it
face.
It should be. I expect it to be the animated Belle face.
Unlike the new doll. I would be impressed if they could make the Emma Watson face in the
topiary. You don't want that. They actually said it's the face from the Oscar-winning film Belle. So that means it would be... You know, this film hasn't won anything yet because it hasn't even come out.
That's right.
So there's a mural also that is almost finished.
And on the other side of the mural is where the butterfly house traditionally is. And it looks like it'll be there again.
Well, it's going up already. It's already part way up. So we definitely know that's going to happen. There used to be a sculpture garden there a number of years ago.
And I think coming up, we're going to see where traditionally the Fantasia figures go, right here in this little Future World area.
Well, it's been there 2 or 3 years. They've used more of the Future World, this would be West, because I think of East as Electric Umbrella.
That's right. E for East, or Electric, or Eeyore.
Yes.
And there is Eeyore right now. Eeyore made a surprise appearance here in the World Showcase with a bunch of other characters.
Right. We saw Pooh and Mickey and a whole bunch of others. Who were out and about. So we went, Eeyore was a little different and with a little tail there.
Pink tail.
We don't usually see Eeyore in a World Showcase. So especially with Spaceship Earth in the background, I thought that was nice.
Another beautiful day at Epcot. I cannot wait to go back. And I think we will be going back tomorrow.
Yes, we will.
So now let's talk Paddlefish.
So Paddlefish opened on February 4th. We were invited on February 3rd to an event. This is the former Fulton's Crab House, but before that was the Empress Lilly, which we both have dined on.
Right, and I love the Empress Lilly, a tribute to Walt's wife, Lillian Disney, so I'll always miss that. But that said, this is beautiful. The location is fantastic, and I would love to be out here dining anytime. You wouldn't have to twist my arm.
I love the kind of the rooftop dining up there.
And the wheel has returned.
Right. Well, I don't think it's the same wheel.
Oh, definitely not the same.
And then the smokestacks. I don't think those are the originals.
So now we're looking inside.
I really like, it's so open. Like almost everywhere you go is bright. This is probably the least bright of the rooms just because the paddle wheel is right here.
And this is the first floor, and this is in the back of the ship, and you're seeing the paddle wheel.
And we not only did the media event on February 3rd, but we went with friends for brunch, which I have a review of, on Sunday, so that we could see what portion sizes look like and try something different.
So I hope nobody is hungry because we'll be seeing lots and lots of food here. Now we're jumping ahead to the second floor.
And I'm just going to mention, this is a very much a seafood restaurant. They call it seafood-centric. And I mean, if you are somebody who's really looking for steak and all that, or a burger, you can find that here. But the it's more like...
Definitely seafood.
Like
it
Jeff
is a seafood.
Loves seafood, so I would go with him and then have something. But I don't know if I'd go on my own as much because there's less options.
And as you can see from watching the video here, it really feels like a floating vessel. It isn't. It is not free floating. But, walking around, you really feel like you're on an actual ship.
Absolutely. And there is a lot of seating. I asked how many seats there are. I have no idea. And they did not either. But there's a lot of seating here. And also... this is the only restaurant at Disney Springs that has a rooftop where you can eat and have something to drink. Look at all the seating, on a roof. So actually facing the water, because I believe STK has the rooftop terrace,
right.
But they're facing more into
so
the springs.
So maybe we'll say waterfront rooftop
dining. Yes. Like the boathouse really started the trend of the of really using,
utilizing the water.
Right.
Exactly.
Because we had been told that at the time when Boathouse opened. So that's really, they brought the waterfront to all the restaurants, I think.
I tell you, if the drone show comes back, this would be the place to be to watch it on the roof of the
Oh, I hadn't even thought of that. And you can see Characters in Flight, which was up at that time. And it's just, we've had so many gorgeous days lately. And it really, this is a perfect place to check that out.
So the important part is coming up very soon, though. We're going to take a look at lots and lots of food.
So this is where we had brunch. And right there, you can see that is where they do the seafood boil. But first, actually, we ended with the bread because it wasn't coming out until like near the end of our meal. So,
well, we had to ask. It doesn't necessarily come with brunch, but it was very good. So I would definitely ask for that. The conch chowder, wonderful. Reminded me of a similar chowder I had in Key West. Highly recommended.
And we enjoyed the beef skewers as well. We shared really a bunch of different items with friends, and those were very tender. Now, this was, I don't remember what her allergy was, but they worked with one of our table, I don't even know.
Table mates, yes.
Yes, table mates.
to make a allergy-friendly version. None of us tried this. I did not try it. I did try this, though.
The crab fries
were much better here than even during the preview, because something about having the big giant bowl and they were piping hot, really good. I quite like the crab fries.
Well, all of the portion sizes when we went back for brunch were very, I thought, very generous.
Here's the Gold Rush I quite enjoyed at the preview.
And you can look online and see what's in really all the drinks and such too. The Bloody Mary, I thought it was just a Bloody Mary. I don't drink them, but when we saw it, it's like, oh, there's a big crab leg and everything.
And shrimp and all sorts of stuff.
It was really like a meal.
This was something from the brunch menu, the Monte Cristo. And I know people will scold me for this, but I liked this Monte Cristo better than the one that you get at Disneyland. And that is unbelievable. But I don't know, the Disneyland one just seems overly fried. And I always get a headache when I eat it. So I preferred that. Whole belly clams, you can never find them. As far as I know, nowhere at Disney Springs can you get this. And I'm a huge fan. I always have to go to the Boston's fish house to get my whole belly clams. And that's quite the distance.
I think the Boathouse occasionally has them, but not regularly on the menu. Also, those fries are excellent. Those are some of my favorite fries now at Disney Springs. And also you had the salmon. That's part of the gluten-free.
Mm-hmm.
She got some asparagus. I like the way they do the asparagus here.
And those were actually alternate sides, so it normally comes with something else.
And this is a fish and chips, and this is halibut, and then sweet potato fries. I don't eat seafood, but you...
I liked it better than Cook's. How do you like that? Well, I'm telling you. I'm sounding like I really like this place.
Yeah. And so I had the petite filet mignon. It was a little too over-seasoned for me, and that would be
too
my
salty.
One.
And you can see there's actually salt right visibly on there. So.
Probably like a sea salt, and I would ask for less seasoning if I had another one in the future.
Right, I would agree with that. But otherwise, I thought the steak was cooked perfectly.
Oh, it was perfectly cooked.
It was just a little bit salty for my taste as well.
And I don't think it was just salt. I think there was a little bit of extra seasoning as well.
Now, this brownie milkshake, this was a fun dessert. It seems this is the new trend.
Well, it's not as, we're going to be going to Planet Hollywood tomorrow, but this one's much smaller. I mean, you have little chunks of brownies and a few pieces of caramel corn and then some whipped cream. So it isn't a huge dessert.
It's more reasonable. It's a nice, actually, if you're not starving, you can actually finish that.
Well, it's one or two people can easily finish that as opposed to some of the other types of desserts elsewhere.
Okay, so now we're going and looking at the preview night. Here is the Florida boil.
Right, and I had mentioned back here they're doing the seafood boil, so... they have a number of different ones. And
fresh
then,
oysters.
Right? There's the oysters. And...
Oh, boy. These were so good. These are the lobster rolls. I would almost say this is my favorite item on the entire menu. And next time we go back, I plan to get the full-size portion of the lobster roll.
Which
pound
is
and a half.
Pound and a half
pound
of lobster.
And a half.
So
I probably did
good...
have a pound and a half with all those little lobster rolls we had. Or I had, not you.
A pound and a half sounds like a lot of seafood. So
if you like lobster, it was very good.
And this is a little bird drink. I don't know if I tried that one. I think I may have had a sip. I sipped a number of different drinks, but I'm not always a drink connoisseur.
Another star of the show, the tableside lobster guacamole. They actually do this. They'll bring this whole setup to your table and make it fresh
for
you.
Not quite as big.
But I mean, it's actually quite nice. We saw it happening for real on the regular day.
It looked like a good portion of
lots
lobster.
Lots of lobster, yeah.
Well, we really enjoyed, you know, really both days. So we had a chance to try a lot of different items, and definitely I would recommend going to Paddlefish. It's one of many restaurants now at Disney Springs. There's so many I can recommend.
So many great options, and especially during sunset. I mean, what a great time to be sitting upstairs on the top of the ship, and I think you can even have your full dinner there.
You can see fireworks from that location.
What a great segue. That is brilliant. Speaking of fireworks, the long-running Wishes fireworks show is going to be ending. It was just announced.
Right, on May 12th, there's going to be a new show called Happily Ever After, and Disney says of it, it's going to be a stunning new nighttime extravaganza featuring more lasers, lights, and projections than any Magic Kingdom show before it. And there's going to be character scenes from 25 Disney films, really starting with The Little Mermaid, so we're not looking back further than Little Mermaid on that. And it'll be interesting to see if it's less fireworks. It's going to be kind of a combination of everything.
Well, what is very interesting is the light show they have now is called Once Upon a Time, and this is called Happily Ever After. So I wonder if there'll be any connection. I mean, they'll be shown very close to each other.
There's
something in the middle, I think, that should be needed.
Well, I think they should have a show called The End, because, you know...
That is the kiss goodnight would be the end.
Call The End.
But yeah, let's talk really quick about this. It sounds like this will be more of a laser light multimedia spectacular with fireworks rather than a fireworks show with lasers and lights.
And it will be interesting to see how much pyro there is in the show. Like, if you're at the Contemporary or the Polynesian, are you going to have the same level of show as, you know, during Wishes? So we'll find that out pretty soon.
Right.
This is an 18-minute show, and it even includes scenes from Moana and Zootopia. So very recent movies.
Very exciting. Lots of news this week. Lots of announcements.
A lot, and we probably didn't even get to all of them. So
anyway, thanks again. That is another show. Thanks to our sponsors, MEI Travel and Mouse Fan Travel.
Check them out for great deals on Disney vacations, and they can book all around the world.
And also the AllEars.net weekly newsletter. Full information on how to subscribe is in the show notes. Check them out as well. Anyway, another big show, lots of excitement. Next week, what do we have?
Planet Hollywood. We'll see more from the Epcot Flower and Garden Festival and the new Geyser Point Bar and Grill, which opens tomorrow at Disney's Wilderness Lodge.
I can't wait to see that. That's been a long time coming. Plus, we'll take a look at the bungalows, see how they're coming along, too.
Right. All of that tomorrow. So, and we'll do a little bit more this week, too.
So anyway, thanks again for listening. Have a great week, and we'll see you all next week.
Have a great week.